Hello everyone, I'm Ryan Stevens and I'm a postdoc at UNH and I'm up here in the White Mountains of New Hampshire, specifically in Bartlett Experimental Forest, which is relatively close to North Conway. And so I'm a research scientist or a postdoctoral scientist at UNH, and I'm really interested in the interactions among small mammals, mycorrhizal fungi, and trees. And so I got really interested during my undergrad in wildlife and pursued a master's degree in Wisconsin. Then I came out here and I was really interested in dietary niches of small mammals, so what they're eating and what that can do for the ecosystem. And I became specifically interested in the interactions between small mammals dispersing mycorrhizal fungi and how that helps with forest health and forest dynamics. So all tree species in this region, they associate with mycorrhizal fungi, and these fungi colonize the roots of trees. They allow trees to take up nutrients such as nitrogen and phosphorus, and they're really important for water uptake as well. And so some tree species can't survive without these mycorrhizal fungi. And so you're probably familiar with mushrooms. Those are above ground fruiting bodies. Another type of fruiting body is a truffle, which is simply the below ground fruiting body of these mycorrhizal fungi. And so both mushrooms and truffles are really important for dispersal. Mushrooms tend to be dispersed by the wind, but truffles occur underground and they need some mechanism for dispersing their spores. And so small mammals are really important. They detect the volatile compounds of mature truffles, they dig them up, they consume them, and they move around the landscape and deposit these spores throughout the forest in their scat. And so by doing this, small mammals act as really important dispersers of this type of fungi that helps trees grow and survive. So to explore the interactions between small mammals, mycorrhizal fungi, and trees, we set up an experiment across Bartlett Experimental Forest where we have live trapping grids for small mammals, and we set out Sherman live traps and pitfalls, which we'll show you here in a bit. We also collect hair samples, which we use for isotopic analyses, so we can actually look at the composition of the hair of nitrogen and carbon and compare that to the food sources to determine what these animals are eating at kind of a broad scale. And then in terms of what small mammals are dispersing, we collect scat samples, and from there we use microscopy to look at the types and the amount of spores that they're dispersing. So to help answer the questions of which animals are dispersing fungi and where they're dispersing it, we trap small mammals out in the forest here. We generally trap in June, July, and August. And so this is our pretty intensive field time. So we check in the morning and collect the animals and samples then, and we go out in the afternoon because some animals are nocturnal. So like mice and voles are out at night, whereas some animals are diurnal, meaning that they're out during the day. So like chipmunks, which you probably see all the time, tend to be active more during the day. So we check twice a day and we collect a variety of samples and we bring those back to the lab to process. And then we spend the most of the rest of the year analyzing those data and writing up scientific papers. And so to capture small mammals, we use these Sherman live traps, which are essentially small box traps. And they're really nice because they fold up and we can carry lots of them into the woods, but we can just kind of pop them open and set them. So there's a treadle in the back where the animal comes in. And once it sets the trap off, the door shuts and the animal is trapped. And so to bait the animal in, we use a little bit of bird seed. So we'll just put that in the back of the trap. And this allows them to find the trap, and it also keeps them fed and hungry during the night. And we also add a little polyester batting to help them stay warm at night. And so put that in the back, and we set these out in the woods, and in the morning, hopefully we have a vole or a chipmunk. And occasionally, we have some larger mammals that find our trap. So this is an example of when a bear found our trap and wanted the seed, and you can see it's quite chewed up. And so we've had a lot of problems in the past few years with bears coming in. And so recently we've set up some electric fences to help deter them. We just got to this site. This is our grid 7. And before we go in, we're going to unhook the battery here so that we don't get zapped while we're going in. So now I've disconnected it from this very large marine battery that we have to carry into each site. And we're ready to go in through the fence here. So one of the main food sources of small mammals are seeds. And so we became really interested in what seeds were available and how that was influencing small mammal populations. So a couple of years ago, we set out these seed baskets. So these are pretty simple. They're just a wire frame around here. And then we have these legs attached. And so these have been really great. We can set them on slopey areas or areas that are a little wet. And then we have this is actually just a sandbag that is attached to the top. And so this is the area that this collects the seed is about a quarter of a meter. And so we can then calculate that out to look at seed fall across the grid. So we have 10 of these on each one of the grids. All the seed falls down through here, and we also get a lot of needles and other debris that we'll sort back out in the lab. And the open mesh here allows the water to pass through so that generally the seed contents are dry. We just had a little bit of rain, but once in the summer, once in the fall, and then once in the spring, we collect all the leaf litter in these and then take it back to the lab and process it by first sieving out the leaves and then counting all the seeds that we collect. So we're on one of our grids now. And so these grids are 8 stations by 8 stations for a total of 64 individual trap stations. And at every station, we mark them with one of these flags, and each one has a unique number so we know where we are on the grid. And when we set these to trap small mammals, we put down a Sherman trap, and every other station has a pitfall trap, which is pretty simple. It's this bucket, and we put some cotton down or some of this insulation so they can make a nest. And these pitfalls are really good for trapping shrews. And this one's along a nice natural runway where shrews can work along this, and then they fall in the pitfall. And we put this plastic plate suspended with some of these pin flags to keep the rain from falling in and getting the animals wet.
There he is. So this is paramiscus. Are a little hard to tell apart, but I'm gonna go white-footed mouse for this one. And it's a new one, so this is one we haven't caught before. So you'll get to see the full process. Megan's prepping the ear tag now, and you can see once I put it in, but they are uniquely numbered ear tags for each individual. So that allows us, once we capture an individual again, so if we catch this one again tomorrow or a subsequent date, then we can know that that's one that we've captured, and that'll in the data that also allows us to have the capture history of the individual. Pull it out of the bag. So then we also collect information on the sex, age, and breeding conditions. So this is a male, which you can kind of just tell. So that has a really long papillae, indicates it's a male. So this one, just by visually examining, it's not in breeding condition. So we would say it's non-scrotal. And this one I would call a subadult rather than an adult, mostly because it's still got a fair bit of gray in it. And also it's just smaller. So a full-on adult would be a little bit bigger than this. So then we take a hair sample. So to do that, you just kind of fluff up the hair on the back of the animal. Just take a few little snips. And we put that in a vial with the animal's ear tag number so we know who it came from, and then an associated sample number. And then we'll also do a tissue sample, which for these guys consists of just a little snip out of the ear. Right, so that's the two samples that we take from the animal. And then, as Ryan mentioned before, we also take fecal samples, but those will get out of the trap back at the lab because it would just take too much time. We also do a weight of each individual. I'll pop them Normally I do this before pulling it out of the bag, but got a little distracted. So we first take the weight of the animal plus the bag, which that is 29 grams. All right, so then once we have everything we need from the animal, we just let it go.
Right at the point of capture.
There it goes. And then these bags are pretty consistent, but just to be accurate, just take the bag weight to subtract from later. And bag weight is, this one's 13. We try to release them close to where we capture them, just because, you know, the animal's home range, you don't want to carry it like 50 meters away and drop it off where it's somewhere it's not familiar and within another animal's home range. So then we just label the trap with the grid, so the plot that we're on, the station that the animal's captured at, and then the fecal sample number. And then later when we're back at the lab processing, we'll put those samples into a microcentrifuge tube. So that's the basic process for an animal.
So what is this?
This is a deer mouse, Paramyscus miniculatus.
Those ears.
Nope, nope. Another little white-footed mouse. So it's a chipmunk. It's a recap. This one's actually being pretty chill.
It is being very
so
chill.
So normally they're a little active.
They're a little more,
they
yeah.
They contort their
big,
bodies.
Really big back feet.
And what is this species?
Napiozapus insignis.
And then its common name is the
woodland jumping mouse.
Woodland jumping mouse.
Please don't bite me while I'm letting you do this. 4386. So you check that against the old list.
So that looks. One was captured a year ago or?
Probably last season, yeah. So, and we recaptured it already this year.
Yeah.
So yeah, so this one is a female. You can just tell the papilla is much shorter on this one.
Total weight is 33.
33.
Total weight is 27 for total weight.
Thank you. So yeah, this is 97 grams, so it's short. Doubled kind of what the other ones were.
Yeah, there. And there he jumps right out. I believe is also new. Yep.
Jeez.
So, lots of new ones today.
What are you noticing about this mouse?
Yeah, so on this one you can tell that she's pregnant because, as you can see, she's a little more round. So yeah, that's a pregnant female.
And they usually have between 4 and 6 pups at a time.
Okay. Female, small, adult, and then it's good to go.
Yeah, I released one today on, I think it was on 12.
Yeah, it was on 12.
There was just kind of a large boulder near us, and I released it. And it...
They really don't have a lot of fear. So once we capture the animal in the field, we label the trap and the station and the ID number of the animal, and we bring it back to the lab to collect the scat from the trap. So the first thing I do is pull this one pin out, and this releases the side panel, and carefully flip this up. There's a treadle in here that acts as a catapult, and if you're not careful, you catapult poop on the next person over. So you have to be careful for that. So remove the cotton here. And then we're going to collect the scat that I use for looking at the types of spores, mycorrhizal spores, that these animals are carrying. So I have a pair of forceps, and I just carefully pick up the individual scats from the trap. And the animals are usually very generous, and they leave us plenty of sample.
It's so small. Oh my gosh.
And so this is from a mouse, so these are very small samples. The chipmunks leave larger samples and a little easier to collect. And so once I'm back in the lab, I freeze dry these samples and crush them up and do a series of chemical processes to them. And then I spread them on a slide and look under the microscope to count the spores that are in there and identify them to the genus. Spores are similar to the seeds of plants. So there we have fruiting bodies, which we'll show you some digging up of the truffles. And within those fruiting bodies are the spores, and they can germinate, and then from there new fungi can propagate. Yeah, and mammals are really good at actually increasing some of the germination of the spores. So gut passage actually allows them or triggers them to germinate.
So we're interested in what the small mammals are eating. So we have seed baskets out at the grids, and then we have to go and sort through the seeds. So this is from grid 1, station 38 out of 64. So I'm just gonna sort through and find some seeds. So I start with the bigger basket on top and I shake it all out. And then I sift through to get the bigger seeds. Not sure if there's any in this one. It's mostly cones and empty cones and needles. Empty cones. So there's no big seeds in this one, so I will dump this out. And now I'm gonna sort through the littler stuff. This takes a while. Okay, so now that I've sorted out most of the hemlock needles, I'm left with just the small seeds, and I'm gonna sort through those. So to get a random sample, we spread them out onto an even number of grids. So I'm doing a 5x5 here. And then I'm gonna take 10 of them and sort through. So we're just getting a sample.
Because it would take a long time to count them all.
And yes. Then I'm gonna take the top two. You can take any two, but we're trying to do at least 25%. So these, I don't need to look through. So now that I have these all laid out, I'm gonna sort through, and I usually do at least two times through, sometimes three if there's a lot more. So I just start slowly and look through. And that looks like a seed, but it's not, it's just a husk.
And this is work that takes place back at the lab. Later, usually, so you're like, and it could be months later. You collect it and you have it in the bag. And
yeah, we put it in the freezer, and then when we have time, we'll sort them.
So here is a hemlock seed. See, this is an empty spruce seed, so it's not counted because there isn't a seed in it.
Like a husk or something? Okay.
But that's what you're looking for.
That's attached.
So you don't record that in any way?
No.
Okay. And the hemlock ones aren't necessarily their preferred one. Their preferred food source are these beech nuts that are they're about 80 times larger than the hemlock seeds. And so this is what they're really after.
They get to the beech nuts, so they chew them up and eat the whole thing, or do they break them open? Or?
Yeah, well, they carry them off, so they'll stash them, and then yeah, they'll chew this off in the safety of their burrow, and they'll get a really nice snack. And these are super high in lipids, which are really important for energy and making it through the winter. So this is one of the, probably the most important food source for the small mammals in the region. But they also do eat a lot of hemlock. And then during the summer, or in the spring now, which is mid-June, they're eating a lot of red maple seeds.
I just found birch seed.
Who would have known that? Birch, that big tree, and that's their seed. That's the seed that makes a birch tree. Mm-hmm. That's amazing.
These are red maple seeds, which are a really important food source this time of year when nothing else is fruiting. So most of these seeds drop their seeds in somewhere between September and November. And red maple is one of the few that fruits in June. So it can be a really important food source when there aren't a lot of other seeds available.
And the sugar maple are about twice that size, usually, their seeds?
Sugar maple are probably, I think, 8 times bigger in terms of the actual seed.
Okay, yep.
And we don't have a lot of sugar maple here at Bartlett, but in other parts of New Hampshire, this is also a really important food source.
That's the sugar maple?
This is the sugar maple seed. And you can see it's got a much larger area than, if I pull out a red maple, it's very thin.
So a lot more nutrition.
Yeah, so to give you a sense, the red maple, the seed portion is about 8 milligrams, and this is about 22 milligrams on average.
Okay, weighs a lot more.
A lot more, yep. Bigger meal.
Yeah.
Here's a red spruce.
Year to year, it fluctuates a lot. This is a pretty low year in terms of seed fall. Sometimes when we would lay this out and sample, we would get as many as 80 or 90 seeds in just this small area that she's collecting. So. Yep. So when we first got out here, we were wondering what the animals were eating, and we kept finding little holes in the soil, and I would put my finger in and it would go nowhere, and I thought the animals weren't very smart because they were digging these holes to nowhere. And after a while, I put my finger in one and I realized that was rounded in the inside, and I wondered what they were pulling out. And I did some reading and learned about truffles and wondered if they were starting to dig for truffles. And so we came back the next year equipped with some truffle rakes, and we started some surveys of truffles, and we ended up finding some of the highest truffle biomass recorded in the world of a truffle called the Laphomyces, and ended up discovering a number of new species, which is pretty exciting. This is Bartlett Experimental Forest was established in about 1933, and so scientists have been working here for well over 80 years, and to discover new species just right under our feet was pretty exciting. And there's really shows how much we don't know about our natural world. We found Laphomyces remicai, which we named as a new species, Laphomyces bartletti, Laphomyces macrosporus, and Laphomyces americanus, which were all new species, new to science.
What was named after the person?
Laphomyces remicai, named after Tyler Remick, who was an undergrad that had worked on it as part of his senior thesis surf project. These are a number of truffle holes. And so when truffles are mature, they release a bunch of volatile organic compounds, which simply have odors. And so a lot of these have sulfur compounds, which are really stinky. Some are really sweet, and they release a strong aroma that the animals can detect underground. And some of these are really deep. So if I put my finger down here, that small mammal dug probably 6 or 7 centimeters down to extract this truffle. So that aroma is a really powerful signal. Animals can sense it, they dig it up, they consume the truffles, and then they disperse the spores to new areas in their scat. And so it looks like there's a lot of activity here. So I'm gonna take my truffle rake, I'm gonna try to dig some up. If you dig up around it, a lot of these truffles fruit in patches. And so we'll see if we have any luck here. We kind of dig back the soil, and they're usually encapsulated in kind of a ball of roots. And so if we feel around here, hopefully we can find one. So here's one. This one's a little old, but You can see this is Elaphomyces macrosporus. And so it's got a little bit of a citrus aroma to it, kind of like a cleaning compound. It's kind
so
of
that's
lemony
a whole truffle, like a fruiting body, yeah. And it's yeah connected it to. Smell
like, it's kind of lemony like to me.
Oh, it's so interesting. It does smell like something like a cleaner.
So if we break this truffle open, Elaphomyces is kind of a unique genus where this outside layer called the peridium is the edible part. And this inside, this one's a little wet, but this would be a powdery spore mass. And so the animals eat some of this outside and they ingest these spores along with it. And that's how they get dispersed. And there's also some thought that as these dry out and get spread, the wind might also play a role in dispersing them as well. So this is one that has kind of this powdery spore mass. And if I pull it out, you can see how fine these spores are. And so these are really small spores. They're about probably 30 or 40 microns in diameter, which is about half the width of a human hair. So very small spores. So there's probably billions and billions of spores in just this one spore carp, this one truffle. Yeah, so when you guys are out in the woods, just remember that below your feet and even within a handful of soil, there's hundreds of miles of mycelia, which are these essentially kind of like roots, but you have to remember that fungi are not plants. They're in their own kingdom, and they have mycelia that are similar to roots, and that's how they're transporting nutrients and water around. And so even within this handful of soil, there's probably hundreds of miles of mycelia. So these colored bits in here, this yellow and there's some whites and others, that's mycelia. And there's a couple truffles embedded here. So if I peel back, all these are fine. This is a mesh of fine roots that are attached to the truffle that they were exchanging nutrients.
Roots of the ash tree.
This is probably a hemlock.
Okay.
They're kind of forming around that truffle, and the mycelia from that are connected to the roots are helping to form this fruiting body. And so this one here, this is Elaphomyces veruculosus, and it's probably one of the most common truffles in the region. So the mycorrhizal fungi colonize the root tips of these roots. So ectomycorrhizal fungi are forming a sheath around the outside of the roots. And there's another type of fungi in this region called arbuscular mycorrhizal fungi, which actually penetrates into the cells of the roots. And so depending on the type of tree, they might have ecto or arbuscular mycorrhizal fungi, and some trees like aspen actually have both. And so in this region, ash trees and maples are arbuscular mycorrhizal, and most conifers and things like beech and birch and oaks associated with ectomycorrhizal fungi. And so these roots are, and this interaction is really important. So the trees are providing the mycorrhizal fungi with carbohydrates in the form of sugars from photosynthesis from the plant. And in exchange, the mycorrhizal fungi are providing the plants with nitrogen and phosphorus, which are really essential nutrients for these plants, and also water. And so it's really an important interaction that's taking place. So it's a kind of whole loop. So the fungi are associating with the trees, and that's a mutualistic symbiotic interaction. And the relationship between mammals and the fungi is also symbiotic, where the mammals are consuming these fruiting bodies, these sporocarps, the truffles, and they're getting a meal. And in exchange, the truffles, that mycorrhizal taxa, are getting dispersed to new areas. So there's kind of a lot of symbiotic relationships happening in these forests.
Samples, and we also have a lot of cotton left over. So we want to make sure that we don't have any scat left over when we're reusing it, because we try to reuse everything. So we go through and we have to pick it all out, and then wash it.